Yeah, good day to all of you. Believe that all of you are doing well. The Lord will continue to move you forward in your chosen field of endeavor, and the Lord will make your relationship to work out for His own glory in the name of Jesus Christ. I want to push forward our discussion on communication a little bit this morning. First, I want you to note that though husband and wife have become one flesh, this one flesh that we read about in Mark chapter 10 verse 8 that talks about oneness in a marital relationship, we must understand that it is not the same thing as sameness. This oneness is not the same thing as sameness. So, and that's why we note that we do not communicate the same way. Our communication pattern may differ. And if we do not get to a point where we have learned to understand the communication pattern of the other person, we may keep quarreling and fighting. Secondly, it will be abnormal for you to be expecting that the other person will communicate just as you do. Yes, we are becoming one, but we are two different individuals. And so even our communication styles, communication models and all that, we may exhibit differences, and you must be ready to accommodate those differences. So that becomes my first prayer this morning, that God will give grace to each of you to be able to accommodate whatever differences you find in your communication styles, in Jesus' name. While you trust the Lord that God is working out a change in the other person. Now, having said that, I also want you to note that some authorities have said that most of the unhappy marriages that we have, maybe about 85% of them, is a result of lack of communication or poor communication. It could be the two. Poor communication becomes a problem. Lack of communication becomes a problem. And the reason being that communication is like blood in the body. Just like blood keeps the body alive, communication keeps marriage alive between two people in relationship. So if you want your relationship to be alive, then you must continue to communicate. When you stop communicating, it's like blood ceasing to flow in the body. That body will die. So in the same way, when you allow maybe crisis, misunderstanding, conflict, and all that to stop your communication, then you want to kill your relationship. So you must be very careful. At the time when you feel hot, you feel pain, and all that, please don't stop communicating. It's very important. And two, don't allow your hurt or your pains to make you to bring forth bad or poor communication, because it's as good as no communication. It's going to destroy the relationship. So bad communication is very destructive. And so we must learn good communication. But the truth is that good communication is an art. It's a skill that must be learned. Nobody is born with it. It is not innate. So we have to learn it. So we must make up our minds that we are going to learn. Of course, I'm sure you are aware that there are different means of communication. They call them languages of communication. And they are developed over time. And they often vary from one place to another, and sometimes from one person to another, such that what one thing means to one person might not be what it means to another. So, and that's why we need to really understand the communication style of the person that we are relating with. Generally, however, this includes, one, speaking or verbal communication. Speaking or verbal communication. And you know that one could be either face-to-face, or sometimes it could be telephone contact. In these are days, all right? The second one is written communication. We write letters, we send texts, we're chatting, email, Facebook, etc. Written communication. That makes communication easy when people are separated by distance in relationship. We continue to chat, we continue to send texts, we continue to, you know, communicate on us. And thank God for the various social media platforms that are available now, even for communication with your spouse, with your partner, when your partner is not there with us. Of course, we also have sign language communication. It includes body language, body gesture, sometimes gifts is part of a sign language communication. You give gifts, different gifts convey different meanings. Colors sometimes, particularly women, they can give meanings to colors and all that. And the shapes of objects can also tell, and with this shape of things bringing me, it means love and all that. So we have the sign language communication. So as people in relationship, you need to come to a level where you have the same understanding of sign language communication, such that when the other person is using whether body language, body gesture, gifts, color, shaped to convey a message, you quickly understand what the person is trying to bring forth. Of course, we also have behavioral language. Behavioral language has to do with availability and attention. You know, if you are talking with me and I'm not interested, that's a way by which I will put forth a kind of behavior that does not give you attention, that tells you, without me saying it, I'm not interested in the thing you are saying. We call that behavioral language. Are you looking for me? Each time you want to come, I run out of the house. I'm not available. I'm telling you indirectly, sorry, I don't need to see you anymore. I'm on WhatsApp, and as I see that you want to communicate, I blow myself out of the place, and you are wondering, I'm not available. So, behavioral language, availability, and attention. We need to take note of the implications of all that, so that these various means, we use it to communicate with ourselves. That's why you will discover that children, babies, when they are born, they are not good communicators at all, because the baby doesn't know how to express anything. For everything a child needs, what they do is to cry. The child wants to suck breast, the child is crying. The child wants to sleep, the child is crying. The child wants a clean up, the child is crying. The child is feeling pain somewhere, the child is crying. So the parent is now left to decode, to decode the message. Now, that's poor communication skill, because we must be able to communicate in a way that the other person we are communicating with will be able to understand what we are trying to communicate in the way we desire for it to be understood. So it has to be learned. So, and you don't grow above learning. So you must be ready to learn. So if we don't communicate well and the other person tried to correct us, we should not feel abused. We should not feel insulted. We should not feel diminished. We should be ready to learn, because we keep learning about communication all the days of our life till we die. And that's just the plain truth. So it's very important that you note that even from the beginning. And you must also note that sometimes the communication pattern or skill of an individual is determined largely by the household pattern of communication where the person is coming from. So, and you don't kill a person because of the background of that person, okay? We just learn over time to keep adjusting our communication skills so that things can continue to get better. And the earlier we start learning it while we are still courting, the better for us. Because when we get into marriage, yes, you will still also continue to make adjustments such that your relationship can work. And the wisdom to learn to do that, the Lord will continue to give it to you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Don't forget, bad communication, poor communication, lack of communication can cause constant friction and even make a marriage to get knocked down, and the marriage relationship is gone completely. So we will continue to communicate, and we will continue to improve in our communication skills as we learn to communicate in the right way. You need to also note in this issue of verbal communication that by nature, women are highly emotional, but men are analytical. So sometimes as a lady, out of mere emotion, you want to just pour out your heart and say a lot of things. And a man by nature, because he is analytical, he might begin to analyze the implications of the things that you are saying, that you may not think while you are saying those things. You may not think about the implications, but because of the nature of the man, he is analytical. So as you are speaking and you are pouring out your heart out of emotion, sometimes you're pouring out your hurt, your pains, your disappointment, and sometimes you don't care how you are expressing it. You are not. You just want the person to hear you out. But At the other hand, because of the nature of the man, he is busy analyzing the implications of the things you are saying. And sometimes you get angry and you feel, I mean, are you supposed to be analyzing, or you should just listen to me and hear me out? Now, those are part of the things that makes communication to bring conflict in marriage. If we don't have this understanding even before we plunge our head into marriage, that the woman is emotional, the man is analytical. Very important for you to take note. Another thing to note is that women are intuitive, but men are logical. Women are intuitive. Now, God has given women a very strong power of intuition, that sometimes they will say certain things, not because they have thought about it, not because they have premeditated it, not because they arrived at it by a logical reasoning process, but this intuitive capacity that God put in a woman will just make her to say certain things, which if a man does not take note, or a man does not watch, the man may land into trouble. Now, but you know, because men are logical, whatever cannot be explained in a logical reasoning process, a man does not want to take it. So sometimes when a woman speaks out of intuition, and because she cannot explain what she's saying, a man may not want to accept it. And at the end of the day, the man may land into trouble for not accepting whether the suggestion or the idea the woman brought. Because he feels that you can't explain this thing logically, so I cannot take it. So you must note that God in his wisdom has given to the logical man an intuitive woman, so that God knows that it's not every time that everything follows a logical process. There are times when intuition helps you not to land into trouble. So sometimes when you want to do something and your partner, who is the lady, is giving you some warning, please think twice before you take that action. Take note also that it is deliberate that God give the analytical man to the emotional woman, because God knows that many of the times the decision women take out of mere emotion, the things they speak out of mere emotion, may land them into trouble. So God has given the woman, the analytical man, to help her analyze the emotional pressure that she's trying to put herself in. So we need each other constantly in our relationship. And I pray that God will help you to value each other and continue to enjoy what God has deposited in the male and the female figure that made him to bring them together. That's why marriage is not for man to marry man. It's not for woman to marry woman. It is for a man to marry a woman, because the emotional woman needs the analytical man, and meanwhile, the logical man needs the intuitive woman. So understand this and let there be an outplay of this fact in your marital relationship. These three things must not be lacking in your verbal communication. One, please. Learn to say please. You want to ask your spouse to do something for you. Don't see anything as a right. That is my right, and it is his obligation. It is our obligation to do it for me. Learn to put please. Please, can I have this? Please, can you do this for me? Please, help me do that. Please, let it be. In fact, let it become part and parcel of you. Secondly, learn to say sorry. Now, apology does not reduce a person. In fact, it actually increases your worth. It's a sign of a matured person. It is a matured mind that learns to say sorry, even when you don't even know what you have done wrong and the other person is getting angry. Okay? Learn how to say sorry. When you have done something wrong, don't wait. Learn to say sorry. When the other person is angry with you and you don't even know what you have done, please learn to say sorry. Let that become part of you. All right? And then the third one is learn to say thank you. Learn to say thank you. Now, one of the things that Jesus Christ brought forth as a critical lesson in the story of the 10 lepers was the need to learn to do appreciation, learning to say thank you. Thank you. And one of the signs of the end time that Paul told Timothy was that he said, people will become ingrates. People will become ingrates. They won't know how to appreciate others. So learn to say thank you. For every little thing, little assistance, little help, little work in the house that is done, learn to say thank you. A man should not think, is it not normal that a woman must sweep the floor? Is it not normal that a woman must wash clothes? Is it not normal that a woman must cook food? No, no. We must learn to say thank you for everything that is done. A woman doesn't say, is it not normal that a man have to leave money for housekeeping allowance? For everything that is done, we must learn to say thank you. Let that become part of your own regular communication, even from now. That the other person remember to call you and say, oh, I just say I should check after you, to check on you. We learn to say, wow, I feel blessed. Thank you very much. Learn to say thank you. Somebody just sent a text to say, I hope you are fine. Learn to say thank you. Let it become part and parcel of your communication skill. Can we then briefly look at the components of communication in our relationship? The first component is speaking, which is the common one. Speaking, you know, that's talking about the verbal communication in which we pass an information across to another person through the use of our vocal organs. Now, the truth is that everybody can speak and everybody will love to speak, even though some speak more than others. All right, so in your relationship, you need to know who speaks more, who speaks less, and you don't try to change the other person to become like you. You just need to come to that mutual understanding. All right. But experts have tried to look at this issue of verbal communication, and they came to a conclusion that it has three components. And what are the three components? The word that is spoken, the tone with which it is spoken, and the facial expression. Now, the word is said to carry only 7% of the communication. The tone is said to carry 38%. The facial expression carries 55%. So it thus means that when you're communicating with somebody, your facial expression gives credence to what you are saying. Of course, you will note that in the Yoruba language, they will say "Oju ni oro wa," "Oju loro wa." In essence, the real message is understood by looking at the facial expression of the person that is talking. So that's why I may come to you. They say, okay, go and apologize to this person. And I come, I say, oh, please, I am very, very sorry. And you look at my face, and my facial expression actually conveying apology. It's different from when I come and I say, ah, sorry, or what else do you want? Sorry. Even that tone does not show that I am apologizing. And when you look at the facial expression, you will know that this person is actually not apologizing at all. So when it comes to our verbal communication, I must not just take note of the word that I speak. I must be mindful of my tone, and I must also watch my facial expression. It must give a validation to the word that I am speaking. So it's very